On March the 20th, 1992, Archangel Media were lucky enough to get the services of John Pertwee for a 45-minute interview on a visit to Edinburgh. I don't know quite what happened that day, whether it was the chemistry or just the fact that we had a lot of fun working with him, but he invited us to join him for the rest of the day and make a documentary of a day in his life. In this digitally remastered version, we're joined by Richard Franklin, who worked with John throughout his time as the Doctor, sharing some of his more personal memories in what is a lasting tribute to a great showman. Well, Richard, it's nice to see you again.
I wish I could say the same, Liam.
Thanks very much. We're sitting down here in Brighton.
I know, I live here. I know where I'm sitting.
You're based now, yeah.
Yes.
Tell me, is this an area that's special to you?
Yes, it always has been. I mean, when I was a kid, if ever I had a half-term holiday, I used to beg my mother to take us to Brighton for the day. I mean, it's that sort of place.
John Pertwee, can you remember the first time you met him?
Oh, yes, I can. Yes, indeed, I can. Yeah. It was in a queue for food on location. Coq au vin, I think we were having that day. And John was showing great interest in this new member of his company and was asking me what I'd done. And one of the things I had done quite a lot of was radio, both plays. I'd done 2 or 3 years with English by radio at Bush House. And John was so nice, and he said, "Oh, really, Richard? That's very interesting. Do tell me about radio." I said, "Well, yes, John. As a matter of fact, it's great. It's a lovely medium. You really ought to try it." King of radio.
And shake your hands.
Very well,
kind hand. Very nice to see you.
Very well.
Lovely to be back at this hotel.
Absolutely.
How long has it been here now? How many years?
140 years.
I can say I was here about 130 years ago. I was here during the war.
Really?
Yeah, when I was a sailor.
Just thinking the marvellous thing of having a Time Lord in the hotel is that you can check out before you check in. You still pay your bill.
Bill? What bill? That's the first I heard of it. I'm very good. I said, you'll probably get it in about 150 years.
Hi, John.
Hello there, how are you?
Very pleased to meet you. Welcome.
I thought you'd got lost.
No. So, John, nice to see you. What brings you to Edinburgh?
I'm here to promote a videotape called The Pertwee Years, which is a new BBC Enterprises video which deals with lots of snippets and interviews and things that Whovians, Doctor Who fans, I don't think have ever seen before, or a lot of them they won't have seen. Also, of course, a lot of the early Doctor Who's were lost, and the idea of these years, we've already done the Troughton years and the Bill Hartnell years, is to perhaps tie up and link lost episodes and explain what happened in between. So they are a collector's item. I actually had a very funny thing happened. On Monday I did the Simon Bates show in London, and I walked into the studio and he said, "Well, congratulations are in order, I hear." I said, "Oh, what for? What have I done?" And he said, "Oh, have you not heard the news?" I said, "No, what's that?" He said, "You've sold out." I said, "Sold out of what?" He said, "You've sold out of your videos." And I said, "Don't be stupid, they've only been on the market a week." He said, "I don't care. They've just phoned me up from Enterprises and said that you've sold them out. I think 14,000 copies have gone in a week."
Yeah.
Which is, and it's number 5 in the video ratings too, they told me. Whether it's absolutely true or not, I don't know.
I'm sure it is. Does it actually surprise you that it's so many
years that does.
On,
oh boy. No, nothing about Doctor Who ever surprises me. After all the years I've been connected with it, and of course I go off to America and I go to these conventions all over the world, and it always staggers me that people are turning up in their hundreds and hundreds to see somebody that hasn't actually been on the tube with that particular show for 20 years.
I didn't really see John Pertwee in Doctor Who until the late 80s. It was through a friend who was a Doctor Who fan, who's been bought a video, Day of the Daleks. We sat down and watched that and I liked it. My first video, my favourite story was Death to the Daleks. I played it to death one Christmas morning and I had to buy it again actually because I wore the tape out.
I remember seeing him at conventions quite a few times and he had wonderful stories to tell. He always started off by saying his name was John Pertwee and that his family came from France during the Civil War over there. And his full name, I think, is John Pertwee de Lannemore. And he was called all sorts of names. He's called John P. Ritt, John Pertwee. And when he had his name up in lights at Broadway, the stage doorkeeper said, "Hey, Jan Putrid."
Do you ever watch any of the old stories again?
I never missed myself, I might have.
Can you still relate to it? Do you look back?
Oh, sure, yeah. But the thing I don't do is I don't remember what the hell happened. Right. And people keep coming up to me in the street now and they say, John, excuse me, I don't wish to embarrass you, but you know the Sea Devils, when they come out of prison, they walk up in the middle of the night, and I say, oh yeah, and they say, well, what happened? And I say, I haven't the faintest idea.
Because you're almost watching it as a viewer now then, in that case.
That's right, yeah.
You did some of the big conventions in America, because they go way over the top, don't they?
Oh yeah, absolutely.
What sort of difference did you notice?
They are enormous in every conceivable capacity. Yeah. I mean, not only enormous audiences, but enormous people. Mm-hmm. Very large, the fans, yeah. The Whovians in America. They're very affectionate, a lot of love in them. Yeah. They really give you a good time and they make you feel great.
I remember hearing a cabaret, a Christmas cabaret, I think it was.
Yeah.
You did after one of them in Chicago.
That's right. I always do cabaret there. I started the ball rolling with that and, of course, made all the rest of the people in Doctor Who absolutely furious because I'd created a precedent and they were all said, what are you going to do in the cabaret? They said, what cabaret? I don't know anything about it. But, of course, I was on the music halls for years.
So is that where you started off then?
No fear. Good heavens, no.
How did you get into the business originally?
Because I've been in it for generation after generation. All my antecedents have been in the theatre. Mm-hmm. And my son, Sean, is an eminent actor now. Yeah. And my daughter, Dariel's, has come out of Beckett at the Haymarket.
So was it second nature to you really then to go
into
the business?
Oh yes, there was nothing else I could do except go on the dole.
But he loved life, John. I mean, he really loved everything. Any gadget he had. I mean, I suppose in a certain respect, sometimes he went on about it, you think, oh God, it's just a status symbol. But it wasn't. I think he really loved his motorbikes and his motorboats and any new invention.
I think he liked motorbikes a bit more than you did, didn't he?
Yes, I like motorbikes. But if I can drive them slowly, I don't like, and he thought I was a terrible wimp, going sort of so cautiously. And Bessie too, you know, able to drive that. Actually, you see, that's a case in point. We did a Children in Need two-minute film.
That was the 3D one.
I was supposed to be driving Bessie. Of course, I stalled it, for real. And if you once stall that cantankerous lady, she will not start. And, I mean, it delayed filming for an hour. And John was very scathing about my ability to drive. I'm an advanced motorist, me. But he was genuinely annoyed because, you know, that's his baby, Bessie. Mm-hmm. And anyone who sort of messed around with her, he really had kind of... Yeah.
So what was your first job?
My very first job was with the Arts League of Service Travelling Theatre, which is a fit-up company where you put a stage up in a different town hall or village hall a night, and you did 10 items, of which two had to be extracts from the classics, and the people chose what you did. And then you stayed with the butcher and the baker, the candlestick maker at night. It was a very rewarding experience. Donald Wolfert, the late Sir Donald Wolfert, he directed me in it, and it was a very good experience, including it taught me the internal workings of the internal combustion engine, because the bus kept breaking down, right. And I then learned how to put a bus back together and make it work, which is good in the 30s. And towards the latter part of the war, I was in charge of the naval broadcasting section and had to go down to a broadcaster, a man called Eric Barker, who was being rather rude about my Lords of the Admiralty. Mm-hmm. And so I went down to check him out, and instead of checking him out, I'd shouted out something from the audience. And he said, that was very good. I mean, he wanted me to. He said, would somebody shout this line? And I said, yes, I will. And that was my beginning in radio comedy, because he then said, can you come back next week? And I was then with him for 6 years until the show finished, and then I had my own show called Puffney Post Office, and I was with Julian Warris in a show called Up the Pole, which this is in the days of steam radio, before television. Yeah. In the Navy Lark, I played basically, when we started, Ronnie Barker did the voice. A lot of people don't realise that was Ronnie Barker who played most of the... Michael Bates, Tenniel Evans, Richard Caldicott, they were all playing the character parts. I played the, you know, the Cockney chief petty officer in it, which are now, incidentally, I rush to tell you, are selling like hotcakes on audios.
My favourite moment from John Pertwee would be from The Five Doctors. He had just disconnected the transmit beam, and as he was walking away, he says, "There, I've reversed the polarity of the neutron flow," which has always been a favourite line for John Pertwee, but I don't think he ever spoke it up until that time.
My favourite memory of the Pertwee years was the Sea Devils. Because I live near the sea, and I always find it fascinating that there's something could be under there, which would be sort of alien or belong to this Earth millions of years ago, the actual story struck me as a good story. And the Sea Devils coming out of the sea in part three was so horrific. I have nightmares going down the beach.
People, a lot of people do. They say that. They say, "Well, the last time I saw you, I was under the coffee table, you know, or I was behind the sofa or something."
Did you ever think that Doctor Who was too frightening?
Yes, we made one terrible error, and I think with the terror of the Autons, where we had policemen with sort of nice jovial faces. And when you went like that and you pulled the jovial face, the jovial face came off and there was an absolutely flat metal mask of a sort of flat head, and they were robots. And that frightened the bejesus out of the thousands upon thousands of children all over the world, because we've always been sparing, well, we spent our whole lifetime telling our children that if ever you're in trouble, you go to a policeman. Well, it's no good saying that and then finding that you pull somebody, a policeman's face off, and there's a monster underneath it. And of course, the result was the kids that moment went bonk. They said, "Oh no, he's not a nice policeman. Behind all that is an Auton." Yeah. So that was a mistake. Then we had another one where there was a troll, little troll dolls, and then when you put it on somebody put it on a radiator, and it sort of came to life, and then it would leap at people's throats and bite their throats. That's one of the master's little toys, Again, that was a terrible error. We should never have allowed that to happen.
In those days, Roger Delgado played the master.
That's right, yes.
He had just this wonderful air of evilness about him.
Wonderful, and yet the most gentle man that ever lived. You've probably heard me say in conferences.
Yeah.
Roger was the soft gentleman. His idea of a really good evening was to put his carpet slippers on, have a very good dinner with my wife and I and his wife, Kismet, and then sit down and sink a bottle of port together. That was his idea of absolute joy and bliss. Yeah. But as for being I think it was in the Sea Devils where we go off in little jet boats and get him in the water in flotation suits. Was that the Sea Devils?
You have the water chase and that's not the
No, that's later on. That's the spiders. Yeah, if it's the Sea Devils. Well, Roger, terrified, absolutely terrified. It took us 3/4 of an hour to get him over the side of the boat we were in into the water in that flotation suit, and the assistant director said, "Oh, come on, Roger," and the director said, "Shut up." Yeah. He said, "It's a miracle we've got him to go in the water at all," which meant that he was incredibly courageous.
Yeah.
Much more courageous than me, because I'm a raving lunatic. I do all these things, I enjoy them.
You know. He did a wonderful fencing.
Oh, that's right, with Roger. Yeah, that's it. Well, again, Roger was terrified of that, but only because he was probably one of my closest friends anyway.
Yeah. That we obviously must be a lot of trust there.
Yeah, like Katie, you see. I mean, Katie did these astonishing things with me. I mean, she'd jump on the back of a motorbike and go absolutely sort of split A over a field. And all kinds of wild things we did in my various motor cars, and Katie would go blissfully with me. The reason why? Because she couldn't damn well see where the hell she was going. She's completely blind. She wears thick pebble glasses, and she's like that, you know. "Ah, Doctor, great!" You know, no idea where she's going at all.
Absolutely. I mean, you know, in the studio, she'd wear these very thick glasses. If it was a shot which involved crossing the studio, she'd put the glasses on first, just to make certain that so she could see where she was going. Then she'd give the glasses to a dresser and aim for where she thought, you know, she ought to be.
I think my favourite supporting character with John Pertwee would have to be Jo Grant. I've actually met her, and she's very bubbly and very happy, and she's also a bit of a flirt.
Of the unit troops, my favourite was Richard Franklin, because he was very witty, and he used to give Sergeant Benton a lot of trouble.
One would have to obviously be the Brigadier, because he's so starchy. He's so unbending by rules. Captain Yates, however, is more relaxed. he seems to be more humanised in respect against the uniform. He prefers to be more emotional. And I think that also causes a conflict between the three of them.
I think that was one of the great chemistries of the programme, that era, Katie, yourself, Nick.
That team, yeah, I agree. Absolutely, well. I insisted on a team. That's why we had the most solid actor I know, which is Nick Courtney, mm-hmm. who played the Brigadier. Yeah. Solid as a rock, you can't throw him at all. We tried many times to make him laugh, but never succeeded.
Yes, we heard about the eye patch.
Oh, the eye patch, yes.
From Inferno was
that's there, right, yeah. Yes. And John Levine, of course, mm-hmm. who played Sergeant Benton, and Mike Yates, and Richard Franklin, mm-hmm. and all that team, and Terry Walsh and his gang, all the stunt boys. So we worked really well, because we had a tremendous number of laughs. To begin with, my producer didn't like all the laughter we had, because he thought we weren't taking the job seriously, and I said, mm-hmm. wrong. We are, but we're doing it a different way. You'll find everybody will be on that set dead on time, and they'll know their lines, and we'll go through it, and that's all you have to worry about. The fact that we laugh about, and when he says cut, we may do practical jokes and things, it's got nothing to do with it, as long as we're providing you with what you expect at the other end of the day.
I remember he was clearing out his wardrobe once, and he got John Levine, who played the sergeant, and me. Neither of us ever seemed to have any money. And he got us round to his house in Castlemore and said, look, I've got all these clothes. They were fabulous clothes. I mean, he had nothing but the best. And he said, I'll give them to you. You can have them. In fact, I'm still wearing the dinner jacket that belonged to his father.
So did you have, you obviously had quite a big artistic input into the character then?
No. That wouldn't be truthful to say that, because we didn't have time.
No.
You see, if you're doing Doctor Who, you're given the script on a Monday, maybe given it on a Saturday mm-hmm. before you start shooting on the Monday, read it on the Sunday, your day off, you're not that keen, you want to rest.
Yeah.
So then on the Monday you go along for the first read through, and you sit and you read this, and then you say to the writers, look, this isn't very colloquial, this isn't in my idiom, I'd like to change this, and what about this scene, can we do this, that and the other? And the director and the writers and the artists would talk this over, and they would then have an agreement whether it could be changed or wouldn't be changed or whatever. Once that had been agreed, that was it, and that was the last time you could have any input into that programme. Well, you couldn't if you went on Tuesday and Wednesday still saying, well, I don't like that and do this. You'd never get the thing done. There was so much to do in half an hour. I rowed a bit with my producer, for example. I came on the set once, we had a military unit, Havoc, they were called. And this is before Terry Walsh took over with his boys, which were really rugged, real tough guys.
Yeah.
And these guys were coming on, and they had army berets on, and they had long hair down a ear. And I said, well, are they supposed to be? And they said, oh, that's your Havoc team. I said, no, they're not. Not for long, they're not, because I'm not going to play any scene with soldiers who've got a hair down the ear.
But, I mean, the fashion of the time was long hair. Mm-hmm. And I remember Barry leaning forward and pushing my hair back and saying, oh, yes, you have got ears. I always remember you said that. And then I had three interviews, and one of them was with Katie, because she had to approve her other half.
Was that an instant rapport there?
Oh, instant rapport, yes. Well, she liked long hair for a start. I mean, it was long by today's standards. It wasn't long, long. It was sort of
was it too
longish.
Long for the military?
Yes, I had a great fight trying to keep it the length I wanted it, but I didn't win.
So one had to dig your toes in from time to time, and I remember going to a cave sequence, and there the rocks of the cave were coming down like that, and when it hit the ground it was a 90 degree angle. Well, caves are not like that, the rocks come down and they go like that, and then there's sand and mud and rat holes. So surely you can put some earth along the edges so that they look at least like. So, sometimes it did get up my nose a bit, and of course it wasn't really my business that to complain.
I spoke to Peter Bryant.
Oh, sure. He's my first producer, only for about a week.
Who said that. He also said that had he stayed, he would have made the character much more comic, and he wanted to bring a comic element.
With
you, do you think that would have worked?
It certainly wouldn't have done, and this is the reason why. This is why I was given the job. I didn't know this until later. That he and Derek Sherwin wanted to make it comic, and they wanted me to play the guitar because I'm a folk singer and a guitarist, and because Pat Troughton had played the penny whistle and had done all that, they said, well, we'll get John in and he'll play the guitar and he'll be like a sort of minstrel and all of that. So when we did the first program, which was Derek and with Peter, if you remember right, I had a sequence where I went into a shower bath.
That's
And I had a shower and wore a silly shower cap, and then I went over and I tried on hats in front of a mirror. Mm-hmm. And then I did a chase sequence with a bath chair going down a hill. Well, everybody said, oh, how funny, and oh, I was so funny with you in the shower. And I looked at it in that week and think, no, this is not Doctor Who. This is supposed to be the world's greatest scientist, not a slapstick comedian. Yeah. And I realized it was absolutely wrong. And if Peter had been gone on being the producer, I would have left. I wouldn't have done it. I said, no, it's wrong. It's not what I want to do anyway. I've been playing comedy for years, and I've been on the music halls for quite a number of years then. And when I was asked to do it, and the reason I wanted to do it was because I wanted to go on and do something that the general public would see me as an actor, and not as an entertainer.
He brought a sense of comedy. The way he used to approach things in certain other episodes, where he would adopt, like in The Green Death, a cleaning lady's disguise, especially with Captain Yates mentioning his bucket. Prior to that, you see him in another episode, or in the very first one, The Spearhead from Space, where you see him totally naked in a shower, apart from a lady's shower cap. And I think that is what he wanted to bring it more low-key, make it more acceptable to all of us, I suppose, a bit of humour.
And of course, again, the voice played a very important part in Warsaw. I remember you on Parkinson years ago, talking about the sweet shop owner.
What a good memory you've got. That's right. Weather Be Wet, the voice that I did for Eric Barker and in the Navy. To hell with it. That character, yes. Well, Parky and Terry Wogan, I know, I've only got to start that and they're gone, both of them. So every time I do the Parkinson show or the Terry Wogan, I did the show with Parky the other day and he said, hello, it's John Pertwee. I said, he was gone. Yeah, that was a lady in a tuck shop when I was at school, and she, bless her, she'd had hundreds and thousands of boys go through her hands in the tuck shop, you know, people saying, one long bun, one short bun, please, Mrs. Thompson. And she used to, because of her politeness and charm, she used to say, thank you very much, Mr. Next. Never knew her name, but always Mr.
Warsaw's another great love of yours, isn't it?
Absolutely, that's my number one.
How long did it actually take you to get that on the screen?
A long time. What happened originally, Keith Waterhouse and Willis Hall, who were the original writers of Warsaw as a film, they wrote a wonderful film scenario, which Gareth Wigan, the famous producer, was going to produce in England. But we couldn't get the distribution or the money together because, you know, the British film industry went through the most awful patch. Well, it still is, that it doesn't really exist. And so they said, oh, well, we'll scrub it out. We won't pursue the matter. They asked me to play Wurzel Gummidge because I'd read the books as a child, and I said, what a lovely opportunity. Yes, great. But I said we couldn't get the money together, and so they cancelled it. And I said, well, don't do that. Write me a pilot, and I'll see if I can sell it to television. So I went along armed with this very good pilot of 3 or 4 pages. It's very simple for anybody to read. If you write it in anything more than 3 pages, everybody goes, oh, that's too much. Yeah. And it goes on a desk and never gets read. But I gave it to a great friend of mine, Sean Sutton, who was the head of programs at the time. And I said, you've got wonderful news for you. Read that. Isn't that tremendous? And he read it and said, no, I don't think so. I said, you don't? I think it's a marvellous idea. Why don't you like it? He said, why? I think it's too fantastic. He said, I don't think anybody would go for all that fantasy. And I said, I'm sure they would. They're sick of the kitchen sink. So I said, well, more fool you. And I took it to Thames, and I'd just done a series called Who Done It. You probably remember Who Done It, the crime quiz that I did for 4 years. And I said to Thames, you lucky chaps, the BBC have turned this down, but I'm sure you weren't, and they did. They turned it down too. And I thought, oh, I'm losing confidence in this. I can't understand it. And then there was a very perspicacious gentleman called Lewis Rudd, who was the head of Southern Television at the time, children's programs. And he read it. He said, I think this is absolutely magical. I can't wait to do it. But it did take us 2 years to get it on the air.
It must have been very satisfying when that actually
tremendously
happened.
And also the fact that they allowed, Keith and Willis allowed James Hill, my director, and I full rein to do what we wanted with it, because they approved of the sort of work we were doing on it.
Yeah.
James and I rewrote every line, but not that they still have the shape and the wit of the writers, but we changed shape a little and colloquialized from my point of view. I knew exactly the sort of lines I could say and the lines that I couldn't say. And of course we cast it together, so I got all my mates in, and it was wonderful.
Warsaw Gummidge was a I suppose it was a great hit, really, for the kids. It was a character.
Wrong.
It wasn't.
65%, 70% of the viewers were adults.
Yeah. Something like Doctor Who again.
Well, very much so, yes. Even more with Wurzel, because Wurzel had an enormous amount of morality in it.
Yeah.
With the Crow-Man being the creator, being he was God.
Did that surprise you then, for Wurzel? I mean, did you expect another?
No, I had a gut feeling about Wurzel. I thought this is going to take off and go like nothing I've ever been involved with, and sure enough it did. Yeah. Within five weeks, we were the media's darling. I mean, we were never out of the papers, particularly the tabloids, and and they always knew that if they went down to a Wurzel set, you're going to have the fattest scarecrow in the world, John Robinson, the boxing promoter, or the smallest, which was the little Spanish guy who's about 3'4", and Big Des, who's now 8 feet. I mean, we had these amazing people. I mean, when we had the wedding, when Wurzel was going to marry Aunt Sally, and it was a superb set. We had a magnificent sort of 13th century barn, and filled with cakes and scarecrows, and Bill Maynard rallying them around as Sergeant Beatrice. And I think it was something like 220 members of the press turned up. And nobody came in sharabangs and coaches and things. You couldn't believe
that's
it.
That's quite unheard of, really.
Oh, absolutely. But I mean, because they all knew they'd have a nice day out, they'd have a few jars and a good lunch, and a lot of laughs, and excellent photographs, because the result was that we made the front page of every newspaper in the country that had photographs.
There are not so many like him now. I mean, that's why, during the Five Doctors, he had a good deal more stature than anybody else around. I mean, John had a marvellous presence on the screen and in real life. I mean, it was partly because he's a very big man. Big people do tend to dominate. But I mean, it wasn't just that. He had a natural charisma. And he was sort of craggily handsome, and I should imagine he was always like that.
Now, there was an article in the papers up here a few months ago saying how you're now a heartthrob.
Oh dear!
You've been voted one of the country's great heartthrobs now. How do you react to that?
I'm reacting with blushing for some strange sort of metaphysical reason. I've looked pretty well the same for an awful long time, probably because I looked unconscionably old when I was young. So now that I'm unconscionably old, I'm now looking unconscionably old and look the same.
Do you find that agelessness has helped you?
Oh yes, I think undoubtedly.
It must make casting give you a much wider scope.
It gives me a wider scope. Well, what I want to do desperately is to do what Leslie Phillips, my sidekick from the Navy Lark, has done so successfully, which is stop wanting just to have things which is hung around his own neck, like, you know, Doctor Who or Wurzel or any of the other things that I did where I was had to be the number one. I don't want that anymore. I like playing character roles in other people's shows.
Actually, I remember him saying to me about, I don't know when it was, probably about 10 years ago, when things started to get quite difficult in films, probably about 10 years ago, he said he rang up a friend of his who was producing a very big movie and said, surely you've got a part for me in this. And the guy said, well, no, I mean, there's only a cameo, but I couldn't possibly ask you to do that. And John said, well, why on earth not? I'd love to do a cameo. Yeah. But you get to a stage where you're sort of, you know, a very big name, and people sort of feel embarrassed to ask you.
All my characters from radio and television, it all came from genuine people.
Do any of the people ever recognize themselves?
Very rarely. Yeah. People very seldom do. I mean, I made a picture called The House That Dripped Blood. It was a highly successful movie, which is sort of a satire, really, on a horror movie, because we took the mickey out of it. And I played this actor who eventually bought a cape, strangely enough, from Jeffrey Baildon, who played the Crow-Man, and went into the shop and bought this cape. But it actually belonged to a real vampire, and so every time I put it on at 12 o'clock, I grew teeth and went up to the ceiling. And it also in the film, because it was a three-parter film, three different stars playing three different sections, was Christopher Lee. And I know Chris very well, and Chris came up to me and he said, I did like that picture, and it was a very funny picture. And he said, I've never been involved in a picture which actually sort of took the mickey out of the genre. And he said, that character you played, that actor, He said, the knockout character. He said, now you must have based that on somebody. Who did you base it on? And I said, oh, that wouldn't be fair, Chris. Come on, you know, you'd hate it if I said I'd base something on you. Yeah. And he said, no, I wouldn't. And I said, yes, you would. It'd worry you. You'd say you wouldn't now, but it would. Well, of course, little did he know that, in fact, it was him that I had based it on, and it was exactly like Chris Lee. And people came up to me and said, you did that on Chris, didn't you? And I said, yes. And I said, the only person who doesn't know is here.
Is there anything that you would really like to do, any part or any type of character?
I would like to have done much more film work than I did, but then, on the other hand, the British industry hasn't got a film industry. And so you had to be a very serious straight actor working continually in straight theatre, West End theatre, and I chose not to do that because there isn't the money in it, and also it's a terrible gamble that you can rehearse something for a month, you can go on the road for 8 weeks, you can bring it into London and you can last for a week.
Yeah.
And then you've got a yawning chasm of worklessness facing you. Yeah. So I thought, no, I can't afford to take those risks anymore, so I stuck to light entertainment, or I stuck to cabaret, or after dinner speaking, filming and so on, where I knew what I was doing and knew when I was finishing.
Do you have any ambitions left? I remember reading once in a foreword you wrote for the Whodunit paperback.
Yeah.
That you would love to play Miss Marple, of all things.
Did I say that? Yeah. I must have been drunk. And actually, I know exactly what I meant by that. Yeah. Yes, I mean, I'd love the Alistair Sim did it actually brilliantly, with his St. Trinian's films where he played the headmistress. Incidentally, did you see Laughter in Paradise the other afternoon when it was on?
I've seen it before, yeah.
Oh, because my late brother wrote that, and I saw it again the other day. My word, it did stand up well. I think what a funny picture that was with Alistair.
And Alistair Sim, of course, is a local Edinburgh man.
Yeah, of course he is, yes.
As we sit here in Princes Street, you told me now that you had a story to tell me about.
Yes, now that's very... I was looking out the window there, waiting for you to arrive, yeah. And we're sitting right opposite Robbie Burns's statue.
Mm.
Where the hell is Robbie Burns?
Which is gone at the moment.
I was going to say. Now, what happened was, I was in the lower deck of the Navy, and I was in a ship called the Hood, which was sunk by the Bismarck, not far away from here. And I was on leave. And up here is the steps, which are the Waverley steps, right?
That's right.
Okay. Yeah. Now, before they put those barriers there, you know, they've got catch barriers along with the road.
Yeah.
The wind used to blow up those steps at a prodigious speed, and people were hurled up those steps into the road and run over by buses with monotonous regularity because it was blackout. Mm-hmm. Now, I was on leave, and our sailors. Lower deck sailors always keep everything in their caps. They have their watch card, they have their money, and they slide it all into two little sort of pockets inside their sailors' caps. And I came up these steps on my leave, and I had a hotel book down here, right down beyond the hotel here on the right, little hotel that I knew. And I had about 5 days, and I had all the money, and I knew exactly what I was going to do. I was going to the theatre, and I had friends who were touring, and it was going to be great. And my stepbrother was a doctor who has been studying up here at the university. And as I came up the Waverley steps, the wind went like that, and my hat went. Now, this is pitch blackness. You cannot see a hand in front of your face. And my hat went with all my money, my watch card, everything I possessed. So there I was without a hat, improperly dressed, would be promptly arrested, with no money, no watch card, nothing, no identity papers. So I was absolutely heartbroken, completely disconsolate. And in the darkness, I thought, well, I must make for the hotel. At least they'll let me in. And I walked down the road, and right opposite here, right opposite, while I was walking along in the gutter, because I always found walking in the gutter was better, because your foot can touch the edge of it and tell you where you are. And believe me, when the blackout, this was black. Mm-hmm. And I walked along like that, my foot went like this, and I thought, I've touched something. I bent down, and it was my cap. And right there, and I put my hand in, and there was all my money, my watch card, everything else. On it went, the strap went under the chin, and I then had a great holiday.
John Pertwee once said there's nothing more frightening than seeing a Yeti sitting on the loo in Tooting Beck. That's a very exaggerated sort of thing to say, but basically he was saying that the Earthbound stories were quite frightening, more frightening than stories set in space.
Particularly like the Pertwee era, especially the first part, because the stories were slightly more believable as being set on Earth and you could relate to them more. A friend's dad took me to see The Ultimate Adventure, the stage play.
It wasn't a lot of fun, Because it was terribly involved, and it didn't involve so much technical hoo-ha with its lasers and its props. I had a wonderful team of youngsters working with me. I mean, they really were good. Did you see it?
I did see it, yeah.
I mean, those kids working all those monster suits and things, I mean, they were absolutely ace. They were better than the people we had in Doctor Who. And because they were young and just beginning, even though they were in a skin and nobody would recognize them, they really worked. You get a lot of rather blasé actors, put them in a skin like that, and they'd say, well, nobody can see me, and they wouldn't work properly. But those kids did, and it did have that verve. But what it didn't have was that it didn't have props that looked good enough. Mm. And when my companion and I were working on the console, that thing when we were being invaded, and all those rockets kept coming in, we were pulling knobs, and they were coming off in our hands. You know, you'd pull a lever, and the whole thing would break off, and you just were made to look a complete Charlie. Yeah. And the whole tour, we said, when is the new console coming? Oh, next week, because it never came. Right. Whovians have always been appreciative of Doctor Who, irrespective of, I mean, when you see Velcro and zip fasteners showing at the back of monsters, or, you know, you see terrible wig joins and things, that never worries them. People used to start comparing Doctor Who with Star Trek and say, well, don't. The Star Trek's got a budget of whatever it is, you know, $1 million an episode. We've got a budget of about 25,000, so you can't expect that sort of standard.
Back in 95, towards the end, I went to, again, a science fiction fair held in Brighton, and unfortunately he didn't turn up. And the reason why the organisers said was the fact that his wife was ill, and we had a couple of replacements instead. And a few weeks later, the Doctor Who magazine printed a letter from him trying to explain his side of the story. And he invited us to write in and tell us our side of the story as well, which I did. And about 2 months later, came flapping through my door was a letter from him explaining, thanks very much for taking the time and trouble to write to him, which is now a prized possession of mine.
If kids, or anybody, doesn't matter who they are, have made a really big effort to come and see you and have walked a long way and have put themselves out, well then at least you owe them the courtesy of talking to them. But equally, there are times when you can go so far no further. And when I was doing the tour of The Ultimate Adventure, I used to come out of the stage door, I sent the stage doorkeeper out earlier on saying, Mr. Pertwee will be out in 10 minutes, but he will not be signing any autographs. Oh, you get all this. And I'd come out and say, now listen, chaps, try to understand. I've just done 2 shows here, back to back. I'm never off the stage. And we had a matinee this afternoon. I'm absolutely shattered. I want to get a meal. I want to go home to bed. Now, if I stay and sign all your autographs, which I'd like to do, I'm going to be here at least for 3/4 of an hour to an hour. And I said, and that just isn't fair. And they'd say, yeah, quite right. So I said, but I would have the pleasure of meeting you. And I'd go and shake everybody by the hand, have a quick picture taken, and then Scarpa.
At your signing sessions, are you finding it's older people who are coming to see you?
Oh, my goodness, no. No. Predominantly, it's in the, I would think in the sort of 18 to 30 group, maybe younger, 28.
And I remember him, the first time he walked into the room, it was just like a lighthouse. The whole room just lit up with the John Pertwee's face there. It's absolutely amazing. He went on to give his talk. I suppose it lasted for about 3/4 of an hour. He finally closed 2.5 hours later. It was the kind of guy he was.
A fellow called Chris Leach, a very bright and smart young man who trained with the Andersons. He set up a very, very good idea and did a superb layout for a show called Star Watch, I think it was called. It had various different names. And I did a pilot for it, an introductory pilot. And he spent an enormous amount of money on this brochure to set it up. But that was an entirely green element and is still a wonderful idea. And we've just sent it to Alan Yentob because he's evidently been put into print as saying, I'm looking for a new sci-fi, and so he sent him that.
computer. Request security procedure of access to file codenamed Project Unicorn.
Identify for palm print scan.
Security code identity, Black Arrow 1 Alpha 1 Diplos.
Security scan confirmed and approved.
Access introduction. Whoever you are that are watching this, you are one of the privileged to be a party to the following information and data. I am Jason Havlin, commander of the Star Watch organization, codename Project Unicorn. It's the late 21st century. The Earth is progressing well. Mankind's technology striving to unravel the secrets locked in all things. Science holds all the answers. Well, not quite. There is one place still that remains a mystery. Stonehenge, a legendary enigma and a monumental symbol of mankind's ancient heritage. A popular speculation has it as an astronomical clock to tell the days and the seasons by. However, the truth of its purpose is not known. Well, not known, that is, except by a select few. Far beneath the stone circle is a vast cavern. And within this cavern lives a crystal. Hold. Access information on the base of operations. Penvellan Cove, a quaint little village located on the Cornish coast. Underground are vast natural limestone caverns. The ideal base for the development and construction of all sophisticated craft the Star Watch organization will require. The village itself is a haven for secrecy, all the villagers themselves being operatives for the project.
It's been very nice talking
to you. Nice to talk to you.
I feel like
you're
I
a great interviewer.
For hours, to be honest.
Great fun.
Thank you for your time.
Not at all. My pleasure. Thank you.
Well, no, it's not that so much as that I'm going to Virgin, and this
we're
is
Virgin
I'm making a PA. If I start walking down the street, I'm doing a PA in the street,
right.
And they're likely to get umpty about it.
Right. But inside the hotel's no problem at all.
Right. Well, where did you want a picture then?
Outside, preferably, rather than inside.
Yes, but what's the story? What am I doing walking down a street like this?
No, what we're going to do with the police box is one just outside.
A police box? There aren't any.
Yes, there's one.
They're
in Edinburgh.
Are they?
Oh,
well,
that looks good.
We'll be right back.
Well, with an interview, a press call and a photo session under his belt, it's only now lunchtime and John's just about to head off to Virgin for his signing session. Follow that car.
Doctor Who never ever went to the loo.
Never.
Oh, that's all.
And only ate once. Mrs. Guham, I don't know what to call her. What are you? You're my sort of mother-in-law.
Would you like a sandwich? Can I help you one? Sure.
Connie doesn't eat, she just dances. Do you do that thing which absolutely corpses makes me fall on the floor with regards to when I see the gentleman do that saluting, I fall on the floor. And one of the funny things is that my wife does, she used to love Come Dancing, you see, that dreadful program. Mm-hmm. And she used to adore Come Dancing, and she said, now to make it really funny and really good, turn the sound off. So we turn the sound, you go. It's wildly funny.
Shut up. It's very, very popular in
Scotland. Well, this is actually starting. I'm on big band. Come into your own office.
Yes, thank you. One sign. I'm going to pass this on these Daleks.
What?
I'm going to sign the Daleks.
All of them?
Children's Hospital, aren't
they? It's for Waterstones, actually. We actually borrowed these from them. They're out in the window. Right. And they've asked us to get them signed. That's what we've caused. Part of them, great demand.
We had one wonderful conversation with a gentleman who came and found to engage Philip. I could see him looking absolutely baffled by this man. And then he came up and he said, "Now then, you don't remember me, do you?" I said, "No." That rather shook him. I don't think he remembered himself. Because there was a terrible pause. Yeah. Because he said, "Oh, yes." And that was the end of the conversation. I said, "You got something for me to sign?" He said, "No." I said, "Cheerio." And he put it in the queue for 2 hours.
That must have been right
for that. That interesting little meeting. Yes. Like somebody, we were at Birmingham the other day, and the tramp came in. Real tramp, a really unbelievable. He had tennis shoes on, which is good because, you know, all tramps should have tennis shoes. And he stood and he watched. He couldn't understand what on earth these people were doing, all carrying around bits of paper and giving me videos to sign, you see, and he came up and he looked at me and he said, "Right then." He said, "Well, I'm one of them." I said, "Oh, well, you want to buy a video, you get them, buy them over there." He said, no, he said, "One of them," and they were the sleeves. And I said, no, they're not, we're not giving them this way. There's the sleeves for the videos. He said, "Yeah, I want one of them." So I said, "Oh, come on then, give it to him." I went to him. He said, "No, don't write on it."
On the day we filmed Reverse of Polarity, John was actually in great pain. Apparently, a few nights before, he'd tripped up over somebody's handbag in a restaurant and fallen and dislocated his shoulder. Luckily, the table he fell at were all doctors, and one of them very quickly put it back into place. It did mean, however, that he was in excruciating pain and on painkillers for that entire day. It doesn't show. As soon as he met his fans, his public, the showman was there again, a true professional. And maybe that's what made John something special in the world of entertainment.
Well, I actually saw John Pertwee at his final convention, which was set in Aldbourne, the scene of his favourite story, The Demons. And 3 weeks later, Radio Kent phoned me and told me that he had actually died. And I was stunned, I was shocked, because I saw him 3 weeks previously at his final convention. And I was on Radio Kent for about 5 minutes doing a live phone-in session, and I didn't actually dry up once, which I was quite chuffed about, but it was certainly a shock when I heard it.
Do you ever think you'll retire as such?
Oh my God, no, what a terrible thought. No, I'd hate to retire.
And no genuine actor would ever say anything else. Why? Because acting isn't a job, it's a psychological need. And that's the thing that sorts the sort of the sheep from the goats. At drama school, you get a lot of kids, so they all think, particularly nowadays, oh yeah, I want to go in the media, I want to go and be an actor. But have they really got what it takes? And that means, do they really need to do it so much that they have to put up with the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune?
John Pertwee is the Doctor!
Where did those Daleks come from?
Well, it's actually Waterstones. They had it as a shop window display.
Did they?
Or was it Sheraton Hughes? It's one of the major bookshops. I think it was Sheraton Hughes, actually, next to
it. Yeah, so, watch out, there's another camera.
I don't know where they got them from, but they were very worried about us doing anything
Target supply them for the paperbacks.
That's what they do, isn't it?
But I think they
Very nice to meet you.
Very nice to meet you. Thanks for your hospitality.
Thank you, Gay. Thanks, Carolyn. Cheers. Thanks a lot.
Okay, you're welcome.
Thanks for the
service as well.
In the words of the Brigadier, do you fancy a pint?
No, I think I'd rather have a dance, actually.
Okay, you're on.